Polish-American Connection on BCTV is supported by the Polish-American Heritage Association and by Loose Ends Magazine.
Well, that we got. Greetings and welcome. This is your Polish-American Connection TV show, and I'm the host and producer, Tom Gajewski. Welcome, and we really have a special program for you tonight. We have a very distinguished guest with us, someone who has a great deal of service to the city of Reading, and we're going to be getting into that in just a moment, but I want to make just a couple of reminders. First of all, please get a pencil and paper. We do have a number of announcements at the end of the program about upcoming events and activities we want you to be aware of, and you may want to make some notes on those things. And the other thing is that this is an interactive program. You're welcome to give us a call, and the only thing we ask is that you state your question or comment, and then give the guest, Chief Bill Rehr from the city, or me, an opportunity to respond to it. And the number to call is 610-378-0426. And with that, I'm going to... Do we have it?
Not yet.
Can somebody...
Can't advance it.
We're having a little bit of technical difficulties here, folks, so please...
Oh, it has to be on there.
If you will...
Okay. Right there. And then...
Can I go back?
Okay. If you will, please bear... All right, we do. All yeah. Right, man.
Slideshows used to work great.
It's really my privilege to introduce a gentleman who has, I believe, 32 years total service to the city.
Well, actually 51.
51.
Yeah, I was a paid employee for 38 years.
38 years.
And a volunteer for a few years before that.
Okay. We have the former fire chief of Reading and now the president of the Reading Area Firefighters Museum, Inc. at 501 South Fifth Street in Reading with us tonight. And of course, East Reading was a bastion of Polish heritage years ago. But it's interesting how the fire service developed, and I think you're going to find it very interesting to see. And a lot of the volunteer firemen, I'm sure, were of Polish descent as well. So we thought it would be interesting to you to see a little bit about the museum and also about some of the history of the fire service that Chief Rehr is going to be able to present tonight by way of his slide presentation. But I'd like to just take a personal liberty here and talk about an experience that I had with Chief Rehr. Back in the early 1980s, he served then as a deputy chief. I believe first deputy at the time, or no?
From 83 on.
Okay. And I was a city councilman and director of accounts and finance. And one of the things that, frankly, I wasn't thinking about, and I doubt that other members of city council were thinking about, was the possibility of a hazardous materials fire in the city of Reading. Just something that wasn't on our radar, so to speak. But it was on Chief Rehr's radar, and he came into city council and talked to us about the need for equipment to go out and fight a hazardous material spill or fire if one occurred. And I remember him talking about the possibility of a chemical spill at 7th and Penn Street. And just imagine that, folks, just for a second, what that would be like and the devastation that could cause, and particularly if there would be a fire that would result from it. You need to be able to deal with it quickly and effectively. And unfortunately, governments, and the city of Reading was no exception, didn't have a lot of money. But he said we needed to have equipment to deal with it. And at the time, there was no hazardous material team in Berks County at all. So we said we didn't have the money. Chief Rehr was creative. He was able to suggest that we purchase a used soda truck from one of the former soda companies that was operating in Reading at the time, so that we would be able to deal with that kind of a situation. From there, it did grow to a more extensive countywide operation, but it was because of Chief Rehr and the people that he worked with at the time that really protected a lot of people in the city of Reading, and I think we should all be grateful to him. So Thank you for that.
Well, Deputy Chief Boyer and Deputy Chief Orlowski were really the people who got the team off the ground and utilized that equipment and became part of the county team.
But you were the one that brought the idea of the soda truck into us originally.
Well, that was presented to us, and I was the messenger.
Okay. He's also humble. Well, with that, I know you brought a lot of pictures, so I don't want to delay the presentation of the pictures, but, you know, just think about the old fire companies south of Penn, the Washies, the Unis, the Liberties.
Reading Hose, Friendship, right. Oak Brook, Keystone.
Okay, there you go. You're going to see some pictures. So with that, I'll turn it over to you.
Well, there aren't too many pictures of those companies here, but the Reading Area Firefighters Museum, Incorporated, is a group that started with two members of the Liberty Fire Company back in 2002, and that was Frank Bryson and Arlene Ratajak. And they saw the need, as time was going on, to preserve the rich artifacts that existed in the Liberty Fire Company station at 5th and Laurel Streets. And so they formed a group called the Friends of the Liberties, and from that small group, a group emerged called the Reading Area Firefighters Museum Incorporated, which is a 501c3 corporation in Pennsylvania, housed at the Liberty Fire Company, and has preserved and helped preserve the artifacts of the Liberties. If I can move forward, this is the Liberty Fire Company building at 5th and Laurel, and it's actually the second Liberty Fire Company building. The company was founded in 1854, and a two-story building was erected on that corner back then by the city of Reading. By 1875, that building had fallen into disrepair because back then fire stations were not occupied like they are today. They merely housed the fire equipment that was pulled to the scene by hand. So the buildings basically didn't have heating, they didn't have plumbing. And so by 1875, the Liberty said to the city, because now they've got a steam engine, they needed horses to pull the apparatus, they needed a much bigger facility that could house the apparatus, the horses, and now we had paid drivers. So they asked the city to build a station, and unfortunately, and it sounds a little bit like today, the city said, well, we don't have any money. Well, the Liberty Fire Company was a very wealthy company because they were in the 5th Street, Callahill corridor there, and that was home to many professional people at that time in Reading, doctors, lawyers, businessmen. So they were wealthy. They also had a talented pool of people who worked at Reading Hardware, tradesmen, and they said, tell you what, you give us the land and we'll build our own firehouse. And they did. In 1876, they built the first two floors of the building that you're looking at. And in 1895, they added the third floor as a large recreation area. And so this is the building today that the Fire Museum's housed in, dates back to 1876 and later on 1895. Now this was an active fire station until the end of 2010. Right before I retired, I was able with the city to build a new station at Lancaster Avenue and Morgantown Road, and that station replaced the Liberty Station and merged the apparatus from the Liberties and the Oak Brook Fire Company. So that's the station you see today after you cross the Bingham Street Bridge. I was able to convince Mayor McMahon, who was a great friend of the museum, that it would be a shame to let the building fall into disrepair since the city no longer had any interest in it, supporting it as a fire station. And I said we should buy that Liberty building. And he was able to convince the membership to sell the building for a dollar to the city. Now we, the Fire Museum, are a tenant in that building. And we're the ones who sort the collections, display and exhibit things, and acquire things to put in the museum. One of the things we have of interest when you walk in the door is an operating Gamewell fire alarm system. The Gamewell fire alarm system, It actually goes back to 1873, because in 1872 there was a series of arson fires in Reading. And one of the things that all those fires brought to light, or a couple of the things actually, was first of all, they needed horses to start pulling the apparatus, because pulling a 200 or a 2,000 pound or 3,000 pound steam engine by hand was a very laborious task. And it needed a place for the horses. And the fire alarm system was a quick means of reporting fires, because in 1872, to report a fire, you had to ride on horseback to the courthouse, notify the sexton, who would climb the bell tower and tap on the bell the number of times that the fire, the ward that the fire was in. So if the fire was in the fourth ward, he would tap the bell four times, and he'd keep doing that until people would show up and he could tell the fire department was responding. Of course, that was a very time-consuming thing, and by the time the fire was reported, most everybody could see where the fire was, because the place was fully involved. This is an operating Gamewell system. The indicator gong that you see there was an electromechanical marvel in its time. This is before electricity and before telephone. And that device cost the city $1,250 for each one that was placed in a firehouse. You could buy a row house in the city in East Reading for $850. But it was a very, very good device, and it served the city until 1984. So for 111 years, the Gamewell fire alarm system was a means of reporting fire in the city of Reading.
And all those fireboxes were part of that, correct?
Yes. The system grew from 30 fire alarm boxes in 1873 to over 200 fire alarm boxes on various street corners in the city. This is an example of some of the things that are displayed at the Liberty, or the Firefighters Museum. This is just a cabinet that has different helmets, different caps, different badges, and other things that represent the fire service as it progressed over the years. We also have two antique fire engines. And one of them is this 1923 American LaFrance engine that replaced the last horse-drawn fire truck in the city of Reading on September 15, 1923. Now you look at it and say, well, the hood says Junior, not Union. Well, this truck had two lives. From 1923 to 1949, it served the Union Fire Company, but in 1949, the city bought the Union Fire Company a new Mack pumper, so this 23 LaFrance was put into reserve as a spare truck. Shortly after that, the Junior Fire Company's 1924 American LaFrance, and in those days, the body styles were very similar from year to year. The engine blew a gasket, or a cylinder, and the city said, well, we're not going to buy a new truck. We're simply going to take the Junior's hood and put it on the Union's engine. So it served another 10 years until 1959. It passed into private ownership for several years. We were able to buy it a few years ago, and it's now housed in the station. There's another apparatus that's not pictured here, but we just acquired it not too long ago, and that was the Rainbow Fire Company's 1938 Peter Persch pumper. That was one of the first trucks I rode on as a young volunteer fireman that was still in service until the 1960s. It passed through four private ownerships, and a few years ago, the owner, who lived at this time out in Toledo, Ohio, called me and said, I have to get this truck out of the warehouse that I have it in. I would appreciate it if you could house it. And I'll get it to you if you would do that. I said, under one condition, if you go to sell it, we get the first right of refusal. He said, okay. 9 months later, we became the owner of the truck. So the Rainbow's Peter Persch came home.
One thing I'd like to just interject here, I know this was a piece of history you told me about, that the Union Fire Company was not originally sited at 15th and Muhlenberg Street. Can you share that with the...
Well, actually, there was two Union Fire Companies. The first one was a bucket brigade back in 1771 before the Rainbows. But that company merged with some others and kind of went out of existence as the Union Fire Company. The later Union Fire Company, which was a merger of the Mount Penn and East End Fire Companies, not today's Mount Penn, but at that time there were two companies, one called the Mount Penn, one called East End's in East Reading. They formed a company that was originally housed in the 1800 block of Perkiomen Avenue, next to what was known as the East Reading Hotel in the Mertz Wagon Shed. They were there until 1905 when the city built a fire station for them at 15th and Muhlenberg Street on land that was deeded to the city by my great-grandfather, Lambert Rehr, who was a builder at the time. And he built over 1,200 homes in East Reading. So he owned the land that the Union Fire Company ended up being built on.
And those homes were built about when, just to give people some perspective?
Well, turn of the century, late 1880s and 90s, and then into the 1900s, 19-teens.
And that was Cotton Street?
Cotton Street, Muhlenberg Street, Rehr Street, Prince Street. His partners were Prince, Hinterschütz and Fricker. So you had the Rehr Street and the Prince Street named after two of the principals. This is a picture of the front room of the Liberty Fire Company's original parlor, which is now one of the prime rooms, display rooms at the museum. This is an older picture, and it was taken at a time when there was water damage to the walls that in the front room that did quite a bit of damage. We were very lucky to get a grant from the Berks Community Foundation to renovate this entire room. And of course, this being an old picture, you have to see the new room to appreciate what it looks like. The gentleman sitting at the table is a fellow named Irv Rathman from the Berks History Center. And he was doing some research, and it turns out Irv's great grandfather or grandfather was a driver at the Liberty Fire Company. So he's sitting at a table that his grandfather probably sat at many times.
Well, I'm afraid I don't know where the time went, but we're down to 4 minutes, so.
Okay, we'll move along here. One of the things you'll see is this wooden transom that says Neversink Fire Company number 3. This came from a building that was built at 3rd and Court Streets where the Shirelli Plaza is today. It was torn down in the 1960s for urban renewal, and I didn't know that the transom, which I'd seen pictures of in old pictures of the station, didn't know it still existed until Kathy Wagner from the Heritage Center called and said, we have something here you might be interested in. And so we went, picked it up. Now, it wasn't in this condition, but we found a lady from the Goggle Works who teaches leaded glass work. She came down to the station, to the museum, and fabricated the glass work that went into it and then re-leaded it. So today that's hanging on the wall in the engine room, and it's backlit with LED lighting.
And we're going to come back to when the museum is open in just a minute. I apologize, Bill, that we don't have more time.
It goes quickly.
It sure does. Okay, if we could go to our announcements, but thank you very much. That was a very interesting presentation, and there's going to be a lot more to see at the museum, I'm sure. The Polish American, and I apologize for this particular flyer, this is one that didn't print out from the printer. Polish American Heritage Association has its May meeting on Wednesday night, May 16th at 6 o'clock at the Goggle Works, room 325. Guests are welcome, and there's free parking in the back. Now, you heard about the Reading Area Firefighters Museum at the Liberty Fire Company. There's the address and there's the phone number. They're open Thursdays from 9 a.m. to 12 noon and Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Admission is just $5, and that's for 16 and up. Under 16 years of age, it's free. Polish American Heritage Association has its Polish American Cultural Center also at the Goggle Works, and that's at 2nd and Washington, and that's open Saturdays and Sundays from noon to 4 p.m. Free admission, parking in the rear lot. A big event of the Polish American Heritage Association is the Polish Open, and that's Saturday, June 9th from 1:30 p.m. The scramble starts and includes lunch, pierogi, galupki, cucumber salad, and dessert. $75 per golfer for everything. Whole sponsorship is just $50. Deadline for either one of those is June 1st. And if you have questions, you can call 484-333-2838. Chance to visit Little Poland, Greenpoint, New York. Polish American Heritage Association is sponsoring that Saturday, June 23rd. Deadline for reservations is June 8th. You can call Marilyn for information at 610-779-5523. The Liederkranz is sponsoring a MyFest with Alex Meixner on Sunday, May 5th from 6 to 10 p.m. The admission is $10, under 21 is free. Food and drinks are available for purchase. And the beer garden and kitchen opens at 5 o'clock. Nativity of the BVM Ukrainian Church at 501 Summit Avenue has a Mother's Day flower sale from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. Polkas are starting for the summer. The Evergreen Country Club has a series of polkas. Friday, May 4th, Happy Polka Tears, Lenny Glamolka, and Chicago Push, Sunday, June 3rd from 5 to whenever. Polka Country Musician, Sunday, June 10th from 5 to whenever. And I want to mention that the East Reading reunion is on a roll. Southern Junior High School is having a reunion, and that's going to be on Saturday, September 29th. And you can call me for information at 610-698-8731. If you went to Southern Junior High School at any time, you're welcome to participate in that. And it's a really a fun time. This is our second one. And then the big news is the East Reading reunion. We had more than 60 people attend our original organizational and planning meeting, and we have a second one coming up this Saturday, May 5th at 9 a.m. at the Wyomissing Restaurant. And you can call either me at 610-698-8731 or Sandy Lubas-Hummel at 610-207-7065. And you can follow us, by the way, on East Reading Reunion 2018 on Facebook. And I want to mention that this will be an important meeting because we'll be deciding where we're going to have it and the date that we're going to have it. So if you can make it to the Wyomissing Family Restaurant this Saturday at 9 o'clock, we'd love to see you there. We'd love to have your involvement for the East Reading Reunion. I'd like to thank Chief Rehr for sharing that information with us. We only got a tip of the iceberg. I know there's a lot more down at the museum, and I wish we had more time to go into it all. And with that, I'd like to say thank you again to the Chief, and thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. And take care. God bless, and always be proud to be Polish. We'll see you on the first Tuesday in June at 7:30. Comcast Channel 15, Service Electric Channel 19. Thanks. Take care.
Polish-American Connection on BCTV is supported by the Polish-American Heritage Association and by Loose Ends Magazine.